there are many places in which I have no business going. The list is long, right? The cockpit of an airplane, for example. I had no experience flying other than really sitting in a seat while someone else did it. I don't have the requisite training or knowledge. I don't have the information necessary to be able to talk to traffic control, to be able to look at the instrumentation and know how we're doing. I mean, I have no business in the cockpit of an airplane. I also have no business in the surgery room in a hospital unless I'm unconscious and horizontal. If you need your appendix taken out, I do not ask for you to come to me. I have no training. I have no knowledge to go into the surgery room of a hospital and take out your appendix. In fact, you might lose more than your appendix. And by the time we're done, you may still have your appendix. I don't know what they look like. I know roughly where they are found in this general region, but you could lose a kidney, and you need those. I have no business being involved in the surgery of anyone else. No matter how much I believed in myself, if I were to go into the cockpit of an airplane or into the surgery suite of a hospital and perform a surgery on one of you, people would be harmed. And it's best that I am not there. And if you were alive about 3,500 years ago, there's another place that I, nor probably no one else here in this room, was allowed to go. There was a room, a singular room, which was used on a singular day in the calendar of a year, and it was a room used once a year by one man. He being, of course, the chief priest, the room, of course, being the Holy of Holies. I wanted to read from Leviticus 16 this morning as we get an idea of how special and how set apart and how unique this particular room was, and also to get an idea of the symbology, the symbolism that is there behind this room. Leviticus 16 begins. The Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron when they drew near before the Lord and died. Mind you, to give you a quick backstory, they brought strange fire to the Lord. They brought an unapproved incense to the Lord. They just did what they thought that they should do. Not what the Lord had prescribed them to do. So the day has come, the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they drew near before the Lord and died. Verse 2, and the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron your brother not to come at any time into the holy place inside the veil before the mercy seat that is on the ark, so that he may not die. Much like the airplane or the surgery room, other people would die, but here, so that Aaron wouldn't die. Don't go into the holy place just on your whim, Aaron, so that you will not die. For I will appear in the cloud over the mercy seat. Verse 3, but in this way Aaron shall come into the holy place. In a very specific way, God gives him that way. With a bull from the herd for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. He shall put on the holy linen coat, and he shall have the linen undergarment on his body, and he shall tie the linen sash around his waist and wear the linen turban. These are all the holy garments. He shall bathe his body in water and then put them on. So he shall be clean. He shall go into this holy place when directed, wearing the specifically prescribed garments. He himself is now clean symbolically. He is wearing these garments to say he's set apart for the task. Verse 5, and he shall take from the congregation of the people of Israel two male goats for a sin offering and one ram for a burnt offering. Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering for himself and shall make atonement for himself and for his house. Then he shall take the two goats and set them before the Lord at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And Aaron shall cast lots over the two goats, one for the Lord and the other lot for Azazel. And Aaron shall present the goat on which the lot fell for the Lord and use it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement over it, that it may be sent away to the wilderness to Azazel. Verse 11, Aaron shall present the bull as an offering for himself, and shall make atonement for himself or his house, and he shall kill the bull as a sin offering for himself, and he shall take a censer full of coals from the fire from the altar before the Lord, and two handfuls of sweet incense beaten small, and he shall bring it inside the veil, and put the incense on the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is over the testimony, so that he does not die. This is pretty specific instructions. Aaron himself would be washed clean. He would wear the specific garments, the specific uniform, we could say, for the task at hand, for being the high priest. He had a bull offering for his own sins, so that he himself was then atoned for. His sins could be covered. And then he brings incense from the Lord, and then he goes into that very special holy place. And he couldn't really even start to begin what he was supposed to do there until the cloud of incense covered the mercy seat that is over the testimony, so that he does not die. There was no Aaron, just do what you want. Go willy-nilly into the Holy of Holies and just do whatever you'd like. You know, if you want to give an offering, go for it. This was a very prescribed and specific ceremony. The rest of chapter 16 goes on to talk about that. And then verse 29, we get to the timing of this specific day once a year. Verse 29 of Leviticus 16 reads, "And it shall be a statute to you forever that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict yourselves and shall do no work, either the native or the stranger who sojourns among you. For on this day shall atonement, covering, being made at one with God, having our sins, their sins, I should say, the penalty given in symbolic form, having this covering given to their sins. For on this day shall atonement be made for you to cleanse you. You shall be clean before the Lord from all of your sins." In fact, verse 31, "It is a Sabbath of solemn rest to you, and you shall afflict yourselves. It is a statute forever." The priest who is anointed and consecrated as priest in his father's place shall make atonement, wearing the holy linen garments. Basically, it doesn't end with Aaron. It goes on. One day, one man, once a year, to make atonement for sins. Every year. Year after year. Aaron and the sons that followed. Very specific offering to the Lord. A very specific place for that one man to go. One man specifically chosen and equipped, specifically dressed and with very specific duties, and a failure at any point meant his life. God has very specific plans when it comes to atonement, when it comes to forgiveness of sins, and a very specific plan upon which and by which it can be accomplished. It's not willy-nilly. When you come to our text for this morning from John chapter 13, and I want to read verse 33 before we start in 36. I'll jump over the text we looked at in detail last week, which was the new commandment about loving one another. Not that it's unimportant, but that it helps us kind of stay with the flow of the narrative here. But verse 33 of John 13 reads, and this is Jesus speaking to his disciples in that upper room. Judas has left the scene, and it's the 11 remaining disciples. And Jesus says to them, "Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me. And just as I said to the Jews," we just read that in John 7, "and just as I said to the Jews, so now I also say to you, where I am going, you cannot come." Move ahead to verse 36. Simon Peter. Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus answered him, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow afterward." Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow till you have denied me 3 times. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you guide us this morning. Father, I echo Gary's prayer that the words that are preached here this morning are from you. Father, use this in this very fallible vessel. Father, prevent my mind and my mouth from teaching error. Father, help whatever comes from this pulpit to be true to your word, to be guided by the Holy Spirit, to point to Christ and to give you all the glory. And should I fail in that respect, Father, silence my vocal locks or deafen their ears. God, may we make much of Christ this morning, who went where no man could go, to open the way to you. God, we love you. It's in your Son's powerful, perfect name we pray. Amen. So good old Peter. A man who we like to pick on, or I should say, I'm kind of bringing you guys into my sin there. A man that I like to pick on. A man that I like to joke about from time to time. I've often said that he was famous for having foot and mouth disease. And that oftentimes the only time he opened his mouth was to exchange feet as he moved from one foot to another into his mouth. But if we were to be honest, and maybe painfully honest, we would probably, hopefully, humbly admit that oftentimes he represents part of us as well. Oftentimes he gives voice to what I think maybe the other disciples were thinking. Maybe not all of the rest of the 11, but oftentimes he gives voice to what many of the other disciples were thinking, but maybe just thought, I'm going to hold on to that for a moment and see how this plays out. Or maybe as the 3 years went on, they just thought, well, Peter's going to say it. I'll just wait to see what he says, how Jesus responds to Peter. But whether outwardly or inwardly, we all have some of Peter's impatience. I would argue we also have some of Peter's overestimation of ourselves. And at times, some of Peter's lack of humble introspection. But I don't want to pick on Peter too much this morning. I think we've done that a lot. We did that a lot as we set up the first Peter series we just did last year. Because we're looking at, honestly, the way God has presented him in Scripture. But I also want to talk about some of his victories as well. Luke 6 is the scene that captures Peter's calling by our Lord. And Luke captures words that Peter uttered that we sometimes forget. Especially I do when I think about Peter. Luke 6, verse 8. Actually, I think I'm in the wrong book. I think that was the wrong chapter. All right, it's not coming to mind off the top of my head, but Jesus calls Luke after telling him to, or calls Peter, sorry, after telling him to cast his net where they had fished all night. And they catch so many fish that the nets are going to break. And Peter right away knows that this man is special. And so Jesus calls him, and Peter says to Jesus, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man." He recognized that his calling, that Jesus was so uniquely different that even being near him was probably going to be a demonstration of the contrast between Peter's sinfulness and God and in Jesus Christ's holiness, that Peter would say, "Depart from me. I'm a sinful man. I can't even be this close to you, Jesus." There's another magnificent scene found in the pages of Matthew, and maybe I've got this one right. Matthew 14. Jesus has just fed the 5,000 and he sends his disciples across the sea. He makes his disciples get into the boat and tells them to go to the other side. Jesus goes away, gets up on a mountaintop by himself to pray, a wonderful practice. Verse 24 of Matthew 14, but the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against him. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, Jesus did, walking on the sea. Can you imagine? In the night, in a stormy sea, winds are against you, the waves are crashing against your boat, they're beating the boat, Matthew says. And Jesus comes by them, walking on the sea. Verse 26, but when the disciples saw him, apparently they couldn't imagine it either. When they saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, and they said, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Comforting words from our Lord. Notice he didn't say, "In a minute, I'm going to calm the sea. Take heart, don't be afraid." No, he doesn't say that. He says, "It's me. Don't be afraid." It's a sermon in that. Verse 28, Peter answered him, "Go, Peter. Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Verse 29, he said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. We pick on Peter, don't we? Man, Peter, you're... only time you open your mouth is when you're changing feet. No, those feet walked on water at some point in his life. Don't forget that. Because he was keeping his eyes on the Lord. "Lord, if it's really you, call me out there, command me, and I will come out to you." And Jesus just says, "Come." And he does, and he walks on water to Jesus. Reminds me of a song, doesn't it, Tom? Sang it last night, one of Neil's favorites. "Get out of the boat." But that's not the end of the story. Peter doesn't keep his eyes on Jesus. Verse 30, but when he saw the wind, that's important. When he saw the wind, or the effect of the wind, we could say, the waves that are crashing, that are beating against the boat, that were now beating against his legs and probably his feet, he was afraid and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Peter took his eyes off the Lord and put them on his circumstances. And he started to sink. That's telling, isn't it? It's an important lesson for us. And I think the greater lesson in this is what he did in response to that. He cried out, "Lord, save me." In verse 31, Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" Did Jesus let him drown? Did Jesus let him sink? Did Jesus go, "You have little faith, go ahead and just make your way to shore"? No. Jesus honors the request of an honest heart. "Help me, I'm drowning, save me," and he saves you immediately. He didn't let him flounder. He didn't let him sink. He didn't let bubbles escape from his mouth to where he's thinking to himself, "I'm going to drown." No, he immediately, Matthew tells us, immediately reached out and saved him. That humble admission of where you are in life, that humble admission that, "Yes, Lord, I've taken my eyes off of you and I have been bombarded by my circumstances, but God, save me." And he does. And yet the storm is not yet stalled or calm. That's not how he saved him. He saved him by pulling him up. He didn't change immediately his circumstances. He pulled him up. He helped him reorient his gaze to his Savior, the one that he knew was Lord of all. Oh, to be like Peter. I wouldn't have gotten a step out of that boat. I'm like, "Mike, come." I'd be like, "All right." There would have been no noticing the waves. There would have been only noticing the waves. And I hope I would have had the honest admission like Peter to say, "Lord, save me. I can't save myself. I have no floaties on my arms. I don't have a snorkel. I don't have an oxygen tank. I have nothing. I am lost, dead, good as shark bait without you. I can't save myself. The storm is too great. I can't survive." I would hope I would have at least the humble admission at that point to say, "God, save me," because he will. And it doesn't automatically mean a change of circumstances. That may come. Praise God for that. And we thank him for that. We don't take that for granted. But we humbly receive his mercy in the way he gives it to us. And when they got into the boat, they're already safe, aren't they? Into the boat? relatively speaking, in a storm. Better than being on the water. When they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Sometimes when we share our praises, when you share your praises, you're helping other people worship God. That's why that time is important for us as a church. The other people were still relatively dry. Their seats were still on, their rear ends were still on the seats. Probably still had oars in their hands, but they were still there in the boat. Peter was the one out there going, "Jesus," and waves. And then Jesus saved them. And they, along with Peter, worshiped Jesus. Pick on Peter. Oh man, does he also give us great examples, great qualities. Some of Peter's qualities, to summarize it, is he had the confidence to get out of the boat because he had confidence in his Savior. He had confidence to follow Jesus in the flesh, even in the face of much adversity. He was just one of the few disciples that was there when Jesus was arrested, even though he would deny knowing him. He followed Jesus in the flesh when he heard the Jews utter death threats against Jesus. If you know your leader is going to get killed, you're probably not going to follow him too closely, but Peter and the disciples did. We don't only need to pick on Peter. He loved Jesus. It's an admirable quality of Peter. He was the first to pull his sword in the garden. Not sure I want to praise that, but he did. He had an awareness of his sin. "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man. I can't even be near you, Jesus." He had an awareness of the barrier that sin erects between him and God, and that Jesus was the only way through or over that. But he also reflects us in many ways. He had a propensity from time to time, as we just read, to take his eyes off of Jesus and to focus on his circumstances, just like the rest of us. When circumstances changed, when fear could no longer be kept at bay, at times he sank under the weight of life. Storms aren't unusual, are they? They come pretty often. I would argue one of Peter's greatest weaknesses, which actually turns out to be one of his greatest strengths after knowing Jesus, was he at the time did not know how truly weak he was. In particular on this great night when Jesus was betrayed. Fresh off of the triumphal entry, imagine that. Imagine the high of that. Like, everyone is now cheering for Jesus. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Fresh off of this cleansing of the temple, where the political and religious life of Jesus centered right there in the temple, when the money changers and the people selling the substitute sacrifices were there, and Jesus turns over the table saying, "You're turning this house of prayer into a den of thieves." Fresh off of that, Peter's on a high, isn't he? And then Jesus does this shocking thing. He washes their feet. "Don't wash my feet, Jesus. How dare you? I should wash yours." "Oh, well, not just my feet, all of me." And Peter's still on this confidence, these amazing scenes, the crowd, the popularity of Jesus, the power of Jesus on display, and he is actually using that to almost translate that into self or overconfidence in himself. Peter's presumption in this moment when Jesus says, "Where I'm going, you can't yet follow," and Peter's response is, what do you mean, why can't I follow you?" is presumption, to say the least. "Lord, why can I not follow you? I will lay down my life for you." Peter's presumption and insistence demonstrated, I would argue, a very high level of pride, that which we too can demonstrate. that nearly perfectly demonstrates the warning of Proverbs 16:18, which reads, "Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall." Pride is an insidious sin, like all of them are. Particularly insidious because it speaks to our character and nature apart from Christ. The self-reliance that we can have, that I can do anything, that I can pull myself up by my bootstraps attitude, which serves us well in many areas of life, but not in the area of faith. In particular, the Christian faith, which teaches you can't save yourself. You can't give enough money to any institution and earn merit from God. You can't do enough good works and earn merit from God. You can't bow down at a temple or an idol and earn any merit from God. You can't pray to non-deity saints and earn merit from God. That it is from God and Him alone by which we have our hope and our eternity. And in the face of all of these amazing scenes where Jesus has this power demonstrated, he's got the populace actually praising him, and Peter's following him thinking, this is wonderful, I've got gusto in full amount. Jesus, where are you going? You're not going to lay down your life, I'm going to lay down mine for you. Why can't I follow you now? Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Jesus' response is one that will make sense to Peter more later. Jesus often did that with his disciples in parable form or even in direct teachings. It was something that he would give them a truth to chew on and to marinate in and then to think about later and then have the greater meaning come to them. And verse 38 is much like that. Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow till you have denied me three times." It's interesting that the very thing Peter offered to die for Jesus turned out to be the exact opposite of what he would really do. Jesus, I will die for you. I will lay down my life for you. Aren't you the one that followed Jesus? You kind of have that Galilean accent. Aren't you one of his followers? No! Not me. Take an identity. I would argue that this scene, as Peter would grow to understand it, showed him that Jesus' love was greater than Peter's darkest failure. And I'm thankful for that. I am so thankful for that. Peter doesn't get there right away, sadly. Luke, and I think I'm right this time with Luke. Luke 22 records what I think is without doubt, Peter's darkest moment. Luke 22, beginning in verse 60. In verse 59, actually, "And after an interval of about an hour, another man insisted, 'Certainly this man also was with him,'" speaking of Jesus, "'for he too is a Galilean.' But Peter said, 'Man, I do not know what you are talking about.' And immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed." The words weren't even fully out of his mouth. "I don't know what you're talking." Rooster crowed. Verse 61, "And the Lord turned and looked at Peter." And Peter remembered the saying of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. I can't imagine that sight. Jesus had already experienced torture at this point. And as Peter denied him that third time, their eyes met. And there are no details given as to expression. I can put it together in my mind and I can say, like, maybe Jesus had a scowl, but I don't think so. Jesus said it would happen. So Jesus certainly didn't have his eyebrows up in surprise. The Bible doesn't tell us his expression. Whatever it was, it brought about bitter weeping. I'd love to speculate here with a sanctified imagination, but I feel like I would betray the text. And I would just love to know what that expression was. Because it wasn't permanent. But it certainly hit home. And even when their eyes met, even when Peter listens to the cock crow, turns and sees his Savior being led out to further injustices of the judicial realm, and their eyes met, even in that moment, Jesus still knew that days later, they'd be having an amazing breakfast of fire-broiled fish on a beach where Jesus would ask Peter those questions, "Do you love me?" And three times Peter would say, "Of course I do, Lord." Even when their eyes met, Jesus knew that that moment was yet coming. He knew that although Peter failed him in the moment, as Peter took his eyes off of Christ, and took his eyes off of even following him and looked at the circumstances and the waves around him, the people, the crowds, the amazing amount of guards that it took to arrest Jesus, you know, this man who taught nonviolence and measured responses to those sorts of situations, had a garrison appointed against him to arrest him, even in the face of all of that, those waves crashing against him, Jesus still knew that at some point Peter would still call out, "Lord, help me," and Jesus would lift him up. Peter is a jar of clay. He's fragile. He can be jostled by this world. He can be afflicted and stricken. But he also knows the potter, the one who formed him, the one whose hands molded him to be the follower of Christ, to be the eventual leader of the church in Jerusalem for Christ. Isn't that amazing? Paul, go, be the missionary to the Gentiles. Start and go to all these cities. Go to the synagogues. Preach to the Jews. Get denied. Preach to the Gentiles. Peter, you're here in Jerusalem. Lead for me. Imperfectly so. Paul, Peter, you guys are going to fight in Galatians. You're not going to get along all the time because you're humans. When you follow Christ, everything isn't perfect. Oh, come on, Paul, time for amen. All those things were yet to come for Peter, but in that moment, he saw the waves. He saw the boat being battered by the waves in the storm, and he took his eyes off of Jesus. But when they met again, he wept bitterly. I think he felt regret. He felt remorse. He felt repentance, I hope. What expression drew that out of him, I don't know. Another video I'll check out when I get to heaven is to see that, maybe. I don't know. Not how it works. It's not the Bible, but boy, I wish. I quoted D.A. Carson last week, but I want to quote a briefer sentence from him this week because he captures, I think, succinctly what goes on, what went on in Peter's life. Carson says, "Sadly, good intentions in a secure room after good food are far less attractive in a darkened garden with a hostile mob. Circumstances. And when we take our eyes off of them and put them to Christ, we can face them." Peter was, of course, restored in John 21, that scene that I briefly alluded to, and I'm thankful for that, because Peter is sinking. He weeps bitterly. In fact, in John, after this sentence in John where he says that I would lay down my life for you, and then Jesus tells him you're going to deny me three times, after that, we don't hear from Peter again in the book of John until chapter 18. Peter retracts. Probably goes into a period of repentance and mourning over his sin, and likely even just trying to go through all the teachings that Jesus gave them, the promises of his death, the promises of his resurrection, promises of his failures, and then also leading them into that great moment of restoration. So at this moment, Peter is sinking. He is seeing all of his self-confidence, his overestimation of his strength in the face of opposition. The waves of the world which crashed upon the rock of Jesus Christ seemed ready to drown him, and yet Jesus restores him. And that might be what you need to hear this morning. My walk hasn't been so great. I've taken my eyes off of you, Lord. Peter, do you love me? Yes, I do. Feed my sheep. Be obedient. Follow the call that God has placed on your life in Christ. Trust in Him for those next steps. And it would make zero sense for us to trust in Jesus Christ with our everything if we still had to bring bulls and goats to the temple. It wouldn't make any sense whatsoever. It would make no sense that Jesus would even have to die if we still had to bring goats and bulls and pigeons and temple coins to honor God. It would make no sense whatsoever, which is why I want us to look at Hebrews 10. The author of Hebrews writes about a truth that Peter knew very well. Probably a truth that gave him great comfort in the long run. Hebrews 10 verse 1 begins, "For since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near." Why? Because on that 10th month, 7th day, bring it again, over and over and over again. Verse 2, "Otherwise, would they have not ceased to be offered, since the worshippers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year." Leviticus 16. Verse 4, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." They didn't take them away, they covered them. Verse 5, "Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, 'Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired,'" speaking to God, "'but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book.'" Verse 8, "When he had said above, 'You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings,' these are offered according to the law, so they're lawful." Verse 9, "Then he added, 'Behold, I have come to do your will.' He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all." Amen. Done. Over with. Have T-bone steaks with your cattle. You don't have to bring them to the temple. And you do so for the glory of God. Make goat milk or cheese or salt or whatever else you can do with your goats. You don't have to bring them to the temple of God. Jesus has gone and has paid the price. He's gone and he's made the way possible for all of that to come to an end. Once for all. Verse 11, "And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time," author of Hebrews has a point here, this is done, it's over with, "he's offered for all time," it's a timeless offering, "a single sacrifice for sins." What did Jesus do? Something that the priests were standing daily, verse 11. What does Jesus do in verse 12? "Sat down at the right hand of God." And I know you've heard this said before, but it bears repeating. The one instrument of furniture, one of the many instruments of furniture, but one you won't find, is conspicuously absent in the temple, is a chair. There was no lazy boy in the temple because the priests were standing. They were moving. They were slaughtering animals. They were making sure the incense was there. They were exchanging the showbread. They were keeping the lights burning. They were filling the lamps on the tree of life. And once a year going behind that veil. Never sitting. You'd sit down for coffee. You're in good shape by that. What does Jesus do? He sat down at the right hand of God. It's so beautiful. Verse 13, what is he doing? He's waiting. He's waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, the author of Hebrews is making his point again, for a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Because you say to yourself, I'm being perfected? I'm going to be counted as perfect? Yes, you are. That's a right now reality. You will be counted perfect because of what Christ has done for you. But you go, I'm not. And you're right. You aren't. Which is why you are being sanctified. You are being made perfect. That's your daily walk. You fight with sin. You war with sin. But you are right now counted as perfect. Yes, the week you just had, and God counts you as perfect. Counts you as righteous. There's no such thing as a perfect Christian whose heart is still beating. He has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Verse 15, and the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. Then he adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Can you imagine the deep breath Peter had when he heard those words? I denied you, Lord, gone. I don't know what Jesus' expression was on that. But as they enjoyed that broiled fish beachside breakfast, there was joy. There's joy as they worship the risen Jesus, not yet ascended, risen Jesus. And Peter was reinstated to his position. We're going to get through verse 25 and then we'll move to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Verse 19, therefore, brothers, get this. Keep Leviticus 16 in your mind. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the holy places, how many of you put on your special, I'll just stick with the robes, we won't talk about undergarments. How many of you put on your special robes to come here today? How many of you took a bath to cleanse yourself from sins to come here? How many of you are a descendant of Aaron? Raise your hand. You have no confidence to enter the Holy of Holies. But for Christ, you walk into the Holy of Holies on a road paved by the blood of Jesus Christ. That a blood of bulls and goats could never do, that would be washed away by the rains. The blood of Jesus Christ opens up the way, the only way, to the Holy of Holies, which is the presence of God forever because of Him, with confidence. With confidence. Yeah, you screwed up last week. With confidence, because He remembers your sins no more. When you repent and trust of them, they're gone forever. When you ask God for forgiveness, He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness forever. I'm so thankful for that, because if I relied on the waves of the world, if the waves of situations, the waves of circumstances, the waves of guilt for my sin, as the estimation of the confidence I have before God, I would be lost. I would be drowning. But God reaches down and grabs your hand, and He doesn't just put you in the buoy. No, He takes you out of the storm and He puts you into the sureness of His salvation, the rock that can't be shaken. You're not on shaky ground anymore. You're on the rock of God in Christ forever to be safe. Your refuge, your waiting place, your strength, your high tower. That's a great place to be. And all of it because of Jesus Christ. I said we'd get through 25. I doubt it. So he has given us confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he, Jesus, opened for us through the curtain, the veil that could be parted once a year by one man for one offering, through that curtain that is through his flesh, because that was just a picture of what was to come. Because when Jesus Christ died and the earth was darkened, the sun was darkened, that hardly an eye could take in any details, the earth shook, there was an earthquake, and the veil split from top to bottom, meaning Jesus Christ's death has opened up the way to the Holy of Holies. You get to go into the presence of God with the confidence that is afforded to you by Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, who's sitting down, by the way, because his work is finished, he said, verse 22, let us then draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, not circumstances, of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water, the water of the word, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Not you. Doesn't say Peter was faithful. That's how Peter got his confidence. No, he who promised is faithful. That is the backdrop for verses 24 and 25. Let us consider how to stir up one another to love, Jesus' new commandment, and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. Why? Because the day is drawing near. That final day. It's drawing near. And Jesus comes back and sets everything right. It'll be a terrible day and an amazing day. It'll be horrible and awful and amazing and awesome, depending on where you stand with Christ. Jesus' first words of earthly ministry were, time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe the gospel.